Welcome back. Kindly subscribe, like, and watch. Today I want us to learn about buying and selling land. Buying and selling land. The requirements for buying and selling land, the procedure, the process, until the end, when we come to the end of conveyancing. So, there is a buyer or the purchaser, and there is a vendor or the person who is selling land. So as a vendor or the person who is selling the land, you have identified a person who is willing to buy your land, and the purchaser, as the someone who is buying land, you have identified or you are desirous of buying that parcel of land. So what is the process? Number one, we call it investigation of the title. Investigation of the title. As the purchaser, this is your obligation. You have to investigate the title before you buy this parcel of land. In investigation of title, there are three processes. Number one, we have the searches. Number two, we have the physical inspection. Number three, we have requisition. We will start with the search or searches. Search. A search is conducted in the land registry. So this is where, as a purchaser, you request for a copy of the title. Then you go to the land registry, you fill a prescribed form, and you'll be given your search maybe after some time. So a search, the primary purpose of a search is to see or to know where there is an advanced entry into the register against that parcel of land. To see where there is an advanced entry into the register against that parcel of land. This is where you will identify if there is any encumbrance. Like a caution. Is there a caution of that? Is there a caution on that parcel of land? A restriction and a charge or any other advanced entry. So a search will help you identify whether that land has any encumbrance. Number two, a search will help you know who is the owner of the land. Who is the owner of that land? It will help you to know the owner of the land and whether there is any encumbrance. So that is a search. We go to physical inspection. Physical inspection. Two is physical inspection. Physical inspection. This is where, as a purchaser, you have to go to the parcel of land, go to where that land is located, know where the land is located, tell the vendor to point out the boundaries for you, ask the vendor whether it is a controlled development area, ask about whether there is anyone who is occupying the parcel of land. If you physically go to that parcel of land, you will know whether that land is vacant. You will know whether there's any fixtures and fittings. You will know whether there's any development or any house or any building. You will know. So, physical inspection is very important. Then, there is something we call patent and latent defect. Patent and latent defect. So, for patent defect, These are defects that are easily identifiable. A reasonable man can easily identify these defects. Then we have latent defect. These are defects that are not easily identifiable. An expert is required to identify this defect. This includes like a swamp, whether that land is a swampy area or things like that. So a vendor has an obligation to tell you those latent defects, but in most cases the vendor won't tell you. Actually, if the land is located in a swampy place, the vendor want to do away with that land, so he want to sell it as fast as possible, and he won't tell you whether that land is in a swampy area. So the best thing to do, conduct your physical inspection, due diligence, ask the neighbor, ask around, do your research, know whether this parcel of land is good, whether it is located in a swampy area. You know that there's a land you can buy, then the whole of that land immerses in water once it rains. So be very careful, ask around, do your due diligence. And one thing that is also very, very good employ a surveyor. Employ a surveyor. This is because the vendor can tell you the land is here. But actually the land, the vendor can tell you the land is near the road. But actually it is near the river. Near the river or there down there, not anywhere near the road. So a surveyor will be able to locate the location of that parcel of land and point out the boundaries. So a surveyor is very important, especially when you're buying land. Make sure you employ a surveyor to point out the location of that parcel of land and also to point for you the boundaries. Those are, we call it preliminary inquiries. Also ask whether there is easement, you know, whether the land is has easement on all those. Then there is requisition. Requisition is where you ask question. Ask whether this parcel of land is has easement. Ask anything that you're not satisfied about the parcel of land. Ask questions, research, ask neighbors, ask. Okay, the point is ask question where you see that you're not satisfied. If they ask where there's any easement, ask the vendor to point for you the boundaries. Ask the vendor to show you the location. Ask a question until you are satisfied. So that is investigation of title. So now you are satisfied with the title. You're satisfied with the investigation of the title. The next process is agreement or the contract for the sale of land. Contract for the sale of land. So when you're purchasing land, agreement or a contract for the sale of land is mandatory. That agreement must be strictly in writing. It is mandatory. This is according to Section 33 of the Contract Act and Section 38 of the Land Act, which state that no suit shall be brought upon a contract of land, a contract for the disposition of an interest in land, unless that contract is in writing. That is number one. Number two, it is signed by all parties. Number three, the signatures of the parties have been attested by witnesses. So for a contract of land or for an agreement, it must be in writing. Make sure that the contract is in writing. What is the purpose of this contract being in writing? Number one, this is the purpose of that agreement being written. Number one, it acts as a conclusive evidence of the facts of the agreement. Number two, evidence. This shows that there is evidence that you entered into an agreement, evidence of the amount of money you paid, the purchase price. There is evidence of the interest that you bought and the land parcel that you bought. So there is evidentiary evidence. We call it evidence that you entered into a sale agreement, the purchase price, the purchase price you paid, the deposit, everything. So there is evidence. That there is an agreement. Number three is protective. They are protective. It protects you against any fraudulent activity that may occur. You know, you may buy a parcel of land, then you realize later that it has an adverse claim by a third party. There's a dispute on that parcel of land in court. So it will protect you. It will protect you as a purchaser. So it will also protect you as a vendor. In case the purchaser fails to pay you the whole amount of money, it will protect you because there's evidence that the purchaser has not paid you. So it protects both the vendor and the purchaser. It also gives the purchaser time to think and reflect whether he wants to enter into an agreement or be bound by a contract. So those are the three purposes of the agreement. For the agreement, there are seven. Let me just go through the clauses, the important clauses. So when you can go to an advocate to draft for you an agreement for sale, or you can draft yourself, but it is advisable that you go to an advocate. So the most important clauses of the agreement. Number one, description of the parties. It must describe the parties, the name, identity card number, PO box number 2, description of the land, of the number, the title number. If it is railroad 2240, like that, you describe the parcel of land and you describe the, are you buying the whole of the, that parcel, or are you buying a portion, and who, by what measurement. Number 3, you indicate the purchase price and the deposit, the purchase price and the deposit. Number 4, you indicate the completion date. When will this be completed? When will this transaction be completed? Number 3, time is of the essence. Number 4, is this land vacant? Is it a vacant parcel of land? Number 5, I've forgotten. Number 5, is it leasehold or freehold? Is this land freehold or leasehold? Number 6, there are so many clauses, but I'm just... Time is of the essence. Completion date, when will this agreement or this transaction be completed? There is the warranties. Is this land free from any encumbrance that does not have any adverse claim by any third party? Then there is a default clause. In case of default, how much will you pay, the penalty and everything? There are so many clauses, and there are so many, but at least those are the most important clauses that you need to put in an agreement. So now the agreement is complete. You have drafted your agreement. Now we go to the next thing. Before we go to the consent, the next thing is consent. Before we go to the consent, it's something I want us to deal with. Eh? So, you as a buyer, the purchaser, you are buying a parcel of land for 10 million. The vendor is selling this parcel of land for 10 million. However, the purchaser has 5 million. The purchaser has 5 million, and the purchaser intends to take a loan from the bank for 5 million so that he or she can pay the vendor the full amount. So in this situation, it is a tricky situation. That's why in this situation you need an advocate. The reason is, number one, the bank will be involved. The bank will be involved. The purchaser will have to go to the bank and ask for a loan to pay the vendor. However, the bank will not release the money unless the title is registered in the name of the purchaser and a charge has been registered in that title. Kindly check out my video on charges and loans. You kindly check. So the bank won't release the money unless the title is registered in the name of the purchaser and the charge is registered on that parcel of land. Number 2, the vendor or the person who is selling this parcel of land will not release. The vendor will not release the title unless he has the money. So what is the solution? This is where something we call professional undertaking comes into play. Professional undertaking. What is a professional undertaking? Professional undertaking is an unequivocal declaration of intention. Unequivocal declaration of intention addressed to someone who places a reliance on it, and it is drafted by an advocate or a member of his staff, and it binds the advocate or the member of his staff personally. It is an unequivocal declaration of intention addressed to someone who places a reliance on it. It is drafted by an advocate or member of his staff, and it binds the advocate personally. So in this situation, the advocate of the bank will have to draft a professional undertaking assuring the vendor that if you release the title and all the completion document. The completion document include title, transfer, copies of the ID, PIN and KRA, and passport, copy of the consent. There is the if required, rate and rent certificate and any other completion document. So the advocate of the bank is saying, if you release this completion document to us, we are going to use this document for the registration of the title in the name of the purchaser and for registration of the charge only. We will not use this document for any other purposes other than for registration. Okay? Then the bank will state that we will release your money within a specified period of time. Why should you place reliance on this professional undertaking? You should place reliance on this professional undertaking because this professional undertaking is a serious document. Actually, like the way I've said, it binds the advocate personally. It binds the advocate personally, and failure to fulfill it is a professional misconduct. No advocate will want to be sued for professional misconduct. So, as a vendor, you should place reliance on that. That is a guarantee that your money will be released. So, when the advocate of the bank writes a professional undertaking, kindly release the completion document. And you just wait for your money to be released to you. After now, most of the time it is after it has been registered in the name of the purchaser and the charge has been effected on the title. Then your money will be released. The bank with the undertaking will tell you within a specified period of time. What the specified maybe 14 days, that days. The PU will specify the amount of time that the money will be released. So that is a professional undertaking. Yes. So now we go to the consent. After the agreement, you come to the consent. You have to get a consent. If the land is freehold, then you have to get a consent from Land Consent Board. You get a consent from Land Consent Board. If it is leasehold, you get a consent from Commissioner for Lands. Then there are other consent like spousal consent. Spousal consent, remember, a spouse has rights over properties that are especially matrimonial properties or any properties that is acquired during the subsistence of their marriage. A spouse has, you have to get the consent of your spouse. The other consent is Kenya Railways consent, where the parcel of land is adjacent to Kenya Railways. You have to get Kenya Railway consent. The other one is airport consent, Kenya Airways consent. If the land is next to the Kenya Airways, you have also to get a consent from Kenya Airways. And there are other consent that may be required or may be asked by them in the land. Registration. Now the agreement is complete. You have your consent, and now you have your consent and you have your completion document. So the next thing is registration. Registration is where you go to the land registry and you register the title and the interest in land in your name. You register the title and the interest in land in your name. Conveyancing is complete once registration is effected or transfer is effected. So when you go to the land consent board, you'll be required to their document that you'll be required, transfer document, consent, a certified copy of the ID, PIN and passport. You'll be required land rates and or land rent certificate if need be, and any other completion document. Of course, the original item must be there. So with this document, now you take them for registration. When you take them for registration, the purchaser will be required to pay something we call stamp duty. Stamp duty. This is a tax that is levied by the government. If the land is agricultural land, you'll be required to pay 2% of the value of the land. 2% value of the land. The government will value, they have their own value. So they'll value the parcel of land, they'll tell you the 2% of the value of the land is how much. If the the land is in town, you'll be required to pay 4% the value of the land. 4% the value of the land. 4% the value of the land. There's another tax that is that you are also required to pay. This tax is called capital gain tax. Capital gain tax. Capital gain tax is also levied by the government and is required to be paid by the person who is benefiting. The person who is getting the money, that is the vendor. So as the vendor or the person who is selling the land, you are required to pay capital gains tax. Capital gain tax, you'll be required to pay 5%, the difference of the transfer value minus the adjusted cost. 5% of the transferred value minus the difference between the transfer value and the adjacent cost. Let me give an example. This is where, for example, you bought land in 2000. You bought land in year 2000 at 3 million. 3 million. So today, you are selling that parcel of land at 100 million. So the transfer value is 3 million. The adjusted cost is 100 million. So you'll pay the difference, 5% of the difference. 5% of the difference of transfer value and the adjusted cost. So the difference is 3 million minus 100 million minus the 3 million. So you'll be required to pay 5% of the 97 million, and that is paid by the vendor. 5% of the 97 million, that is paid by the vendor. So that is all for the requirements for buying and selling land. Thank you for always coming back to my channel and watching. God bless.